So you could just go on and on by taking a system apart and looking at its parts. So let's start from a biological cell. We look at the parts, then we have molecules, look at the parts, we have atoms, and we can go further down, of course, what some physicists like to do. But that's not the whole story. Higher levels have also their own concepts and laws that are not part of the lower level. So for instance, let's take psychology. An inferiority complex is a concept that is just not part of any of the lower levels. Reduction, as successful as it is not complete, not exact, requires additional assumptions that go beyond the lower level. In this case, something truly new would come into play at the next level. And then we speak about strong emergence. Reductionism can also be found in biology, and of course the most famous proponent is Richard Dawkins. Here is one of his famous quotations. "We are machines for propagating DNA, and the propagation of DNA is a self-sustaining process. It is every living object's sole reason for living." So it's again this bottom-up view, the lower level, the genes determine us. I told you that particle physicists often tend to have this reductionist view. Solid-state physicists, who deal with larger objects composed of atoms, have different views, because they just know from their practice of physics that they never ever explain the whole system in terms of a full theory of the atoms and their interactions. The ability to reduce everything to simple fundamental laws does not imply the possibility to start from those laws and reconstruct the universe. So, in other words, given quantum field theory, you could never ever predict that there is such a thing as an elephant. For instance, there's another person whom I like to quote, Tony Leggett. He says it very bluntly. "No significant advance in the theory of matter and bulk has ever come about through derivation from microscopic principles. The so-called derivations from microscopic principles alone are almost all bogus." And if the lower level is not fully deterministic, does not fully determine what happens up there, there is, in the opposite direction, influence from the higher level to the lower level. Here is one of my favorite quotations concerning top-down causation and relating it to bottom-up causation. So it's from the book by Dennis Noble, The Music of Life, and he contrasts the view of Richard Dawkins with his own view, which is less reductionist. And he says, "Exactly the same fact, namely that genes are in our bodies, can be interpreted in both ways, looking at the bottom-up effects or concentrating on the top-down effects." Here, that's a quotation again from Richard Dawkins. "The genes swarm safe inside gigantic lumbering robots. They created us, body and mind. Their preservation is the ultimate rationale for our existence." And Dennis Noble describes exactly the same fact by these words. "The genes are trapped in huge colonies, locked inside highly intelligent beings. We are the system that allows their code to be read. We are the ultimate rationale for their existence." So he focuses on the fact that no gene can get expressed if the regulatory mechanisms of our body don't allow it. So the poor gene can do nothing if it's not read and translated to a protein. Of course, there's some truth to both statements. There's always bottom-up influence, but there are also lots of top-down influences. And George Ellis has written a book on all these top-down influences, and when you read it, it just opens your eyes that they are everywhere. We are just not so used to looking at them because we are so trained to looking at the bottom-up influences. And it occurred to me also that this whole intelligent design movement is kind of an interventionist view, because they always try to explain, if you just had the laws of physics, then life would be too improbable. But God is intervening and changing the course of things such that the first cell was formed. So it's a typical interventionist view, and it presupposes this reductionist view that the world of physics is causally closed. This question how things would go if there was just physics, it's not a meaningful question, because physics simply does not determine everything.